Hi all. Well, tonight we're going to talk about the inverse function theorem, a very useful theorem from advanced calculus. The inverse function theorem is concerned with a function h that maps Rn to Rn bar. So by Rn bar here, I simply mean another instance of Rn that we're just going to consider distinct from the domain of h. In general, h may be a nonlinear function of its n variables, and we require that it be continuous and differentiable within its domain. The inverse function theorem is concerned with finding the inverse of the function h that lets you reverse this transformation of points in Rn and send them back to where they started using h inverse. H can be a coordinate transformation function, so suppose you have some coordinates xi on an n-dimensional manifold. You can have a continuous differentiable function that converts those into a bunch of new coordinates y. And for the new coordinates to be valid, useful coordinate, this function h must be invertible, and it has to obey some other properties. H is giving you n different numbers for each point in Rn. You can write out the n functions, the components of the function h, in column format here. So this function h is mapping an element of Rn over here to some y values over here in Rn bar. And so for each y, there has to be a component function h of x1 through xn, and so on. So this definition of h here is actually defining n separate functions, each of which must be continuous and differentiable. We'll call this equation 1 right here in this column notation. Okay, so how do we go about finding the inverse function of h? The function h consists of these n components, hk, and each one of the functions hk is a function of n variables here, and it maps to a single variable in R. For instance, the variable y1 is given by the function h1 of xi of n variables here, and y1 is an element of the real numbers. Okay, so a little discussion about h and h inverse and our notation here. If the inverse function exists, then it has this feature that if you compose original function h with its inverse function, this is function composition here, it gives you the identity map. So this composition of functions right here is going to map the x's back to themselves. What about if we reverse this and put the composition of h inverse with h? Your operation is confined to either Rn in this order or the Rn bar, the space where we have y coordinates. Now this minus 1 notation is going to get in the way because we're using the superscript and subscript notation for the components of the points in Rn, and so we're going to switch over to a notation where instead of h to the minus 1, we're going to call the inverse of h h bar. So h bar can be read as h inverse. Going to make our equations look a little cleaner. Now, how do we go about finding the inverse function? Here is the key observation that lets us get going on this problem. Since the function h is continuous and differentiable, the h function becomes a linear function locally. So if you restrict your attention to a an epsilon neighborhood around a point in Rn, then if we evaluate h in that neighborhood, it becomes a linear function. So an epsilon neighborhood of a point xp becomes an n-dimensional vector space of differentials dx with components dxk. We will call this local space, local vector space at the point xp, drn at xp. So if you're thinking of Rn as a manifold, then this local linear space of differentials would be called the tangent space of the manifold Rn at the point xp. We have this differential structure in Rn, and locally there are linear spaces of differentials. Most of you have already seen this, but just as a refresher, the elements of the vector space are of the form xp plus dx, and xp is serving as the zero vector of the vector space drn at xp. Now, notice that even though we have this new space drn of xp, every vector in drn of xp is a point in Rn. So, for example, a vector A that's an element of drn at xp is written as xp plus dx, and clearly this has coordinates in Rn. I wanted to mention this because sometimes when we're talking about tangent spaces and these local spaces of differentials, they start to seem a little bit divorced from the original manifold, but the space of local differentials are all points in Rn, and in fact the union of all such local spaces of differentials turns out to be the entire space Rn. Now, the fact that H maps X to Y in Rn implies that we can map the entire linear space of differentials at xp to a linear space of differentials at yp. Let's see how that works. First, we observe that the function h preserves the vector algebra of differentials, that we want this h to convert epsilon neighborhoods in the x-coordinates into epsilon neighborhoods in the y-coordinates. It preserves the fact that those epsilon neighborhoods are linear spaces of differentials. Okay, so now that we have this differential structure, let's examine the action of h on the local linear space of differentials at xp. So we can evaluate h at xp, and that gives us a point yp over here. And we can also evaluate h of xp plus dx, and that's going to give you the original point y plus the differential around yp. We observe that the component functions of h, the hj's, are differentiable. And so when we write out these equations in terms of the hj's, you get something very useful. So we have equation 3 here, the value of h at the point xp plus dx. So we can write this out in terms of the component functions hj. And since the hj's are differentiable, we can write h of this sum of xp plus the differential dxi as the value of h at xp plus the derivatives of h with respect to x times dxi. And the values of hj at xp are just the yj's. We also have hj of x plus dx is equal to y plus dy. So we have two equations here for hj at x plus dx, and so we can subtract these two, and you get an equation for dyj. So the action of the function h on the local space of differentials gives you dy as a linear function of the differentials dx. We now have a linear equation for dy, and h has become a linear function of the differentials dx. So h is really represented by an n by n matrix, and I'll write this with an upstairs index and a downstairs index. dhj dxi is equal to this n by n array, and we're evaluating this at the particular point x equals xp. So this is an n by n matrix in the dxi basis. Now, this matrix has a special name. It's called the Jacobian matrix of the transformation, and in the Jacobian notation, this matrix is written as sort of this funny partial derivative looking thing with the H's enumerated on top and the independent variables X's on the bottom. So the thing about Jacobians in this notation, the functions are upstairs and the independent variables are downstairs. This Jacobian just refers exactly to this derivative that we derived. Okay, a little bit on Jacobians. Now, we have this equation right here. So to solve this equation, we just need to invert this matrix, dhj by dxi. Okay, so let's take a look at that. So we note the original problem is reduced to inverting the matrix hji. No such a matrix is invertible if the determinant of the matrix is non-zero. If that's the case, then the inverse matrix h bar exists, and it gives you the coordinate transformation going back the other way from the y coordinates to the x coordinates. So in terms of manifolds where we have coordinates and transformations, we have now inverted the coordinate transformation locally at the point xp. Not only do we know that the matrix h bar exists, but we can actually find the elements of h bar, you know, using Cramer's rule or in other ways. Now, this is very important. We've really just proved this inverse function exists, and we've been able to show how to calculate it. In a neighborhood of a point xp, so to complete the problem, we need to repeat this derivation for every point xp in some subset of Rn. So if we call this subset q alpha, this is some extended region in Rn, might even be the entire space Rn. So we're going to repeat this for every point where it works. You know, you can end up with regions where the function is not invertible, and so those coordinates are no longer any good. You have to find some new coordinates. So in some extended region of Rn, we can repeat this process and establish H inverse on the image of Q alpha in Rn bar. Call it Q alpha bar. So H inverse maps Q alpha bar back to Q alpha. So the determinant that we were talking about then becomes a function of points in this region Q alpha in Rn. Okay. This completes the proof of the theorem. So that wasn't too bad. Before I state the theorem formally, I have to remind us that when we say a CK function, h is a CK function, it means that the function h is continuous and differentiable k times. So a CK function, you can differentiate it k times, and still have a continuous function. Some manifolds require functions to be C infinity. These are called smooth manifolds. But more generally, you can just allow H to be CK continuous. Okay. Inverse function theorem for CK functions. Consider a function H that maps Qn to Rn bar. And the function H is a CK mapping. And Qn is an open subset of Rn. If H is invertible, namely, if the rank of the Jacobian J of H on X at X equals XP, if the rank of this Jacobian is equal to n for all XP and Qn, then H inverse exists and is continuous and differentiable on the range of H of Qn to Qn bar in Rn bar. And this is equivalent to saying that the determinant of J is non-zero in this region. If such an inverse function exists and has these properties, then the new coordinates you get from the old ones are good coordinates of the manifold. So this theorem is useful for constructing and testing new coordinate systems. Okay, so I think that's about all we wanted to talk about tonight. This is a really interesting subject, and I hope you enjoyed it. Please leave any questions or comments on YouTube.